On the 3rd of May 1837, the first university in Greece was born. On the 3rd of May 1987, the University of Athens celebrated its 150-year anniversary. And, as the Athens press characterized it, it was the birthday anniversary of 150 years of science and wisdom. Many events were held as part of the general celebrations. The Prime Minister held a dinner for foreign guests of the university. At a concert hall in Athens, a premiere performance was given of Theodorakis' work, The Fourth Symphony of the Rustics, which was written especially for the university's 150-year anniversary. And finally, at official ceremonies, the poets Odysseus Elitis and Yannis Ritsos were awarded honorary doctorates by the arts faculty. In the ceremonial hall of the central building of the university, the 150-year anniversary was celebrated officially in the presence of the President of the Republic, the Prime Minister, the Speaker of the Parliament, members of the government, party leaders, MPs, foreign ambassadors, members of the University Senate, clerical dignitaries, artists, and 80 representatives from foreign universities.
Everything is ready for the ceremony to begin. The first to speak is the President of the Republic, Christos Ardzetakis.
Πρώτος ανεβαίνει στο βήμα ο πρόεδρος της Δημοκρατίας, κύριος Χρήστος Ardzetakis.
Κύριε Πρίτανη,
Mr. Chancellor,
με αισθήματα ιδιαίτερης χαράς,
it is with feelings of a special pleasure and pride that we have gathered here today to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the functioning of the National University of Athens.
Του Εθνικού και Καποδιστριακού Πανεπιστημίου Αθηνών. Που είναι συγχρόνως.
It is also 150 years of the existence of a university in the modern Greek state.
Πράγμα που σημαίνει.
This doesn't mean, however, that a university was established in Greece only 150 years ago, but rather it was re-established in Greece 150 years ago. For, in truth, a university was in existence in Greece long before all the other European universities, which first appeared on the European horizon in the 12th century and later.
Την συνείδηση ακριβώς αυτής της συνηθίας, την αντίληψη ότι απλώς...
Τα 75 χρόνια από την ίδρυσή του...
In 1912, the university celebrated its first 75 years. In the preceding year, 1911, it acquired a working statue.
Ακόμα νωρίτερα...
Even earlier, the government had dismissed 21 out of 58 teaching staff. A purge of teaching staff seemed to be the preferred method for dealing with the university crisis. The 75-year anniversary of the university coincides more generally with the endeavors at the time for national reorganization, and the Venizelos government gave a special emphasis to the area of education. The university's role was reorientated. Higher education in a modern state had the task of creating academics and scientists who would serve a useful purpose in society.
The purpose of any law school is the education and training of legists, but this is not its only purpose in the field of law. It also serves the purpose of staffing public administration, either with civil servants, or with teachers, or with legislators. Clearly, another duty of the law schools is the education of the members of those advisory committees who undertake to organize the precise and correct formulation of the laws. Any questions?
During the first years of the Greek state, when there still was no law school, who were the people who constituted these advisory legislative committees?
In the first years of the modern Greek state, many people lacked the most rudimentary education, let alone a legal training. Nevertheless, the first legislative texts and formulas for the political composition of the state were of a high level. Following this, of course, the requirements were much more demanding. It is characteristic that, after the assassination of the Greek Prime Minister John Kapodistrias, and when Otto, the son of the Bavarian King Ludovic I, came to Greece as king, the laws were published in German as well as Greek for a considerable number of years in the government papers. This was because, on the one hand, Greece did not have many legists who could sit on the legislative committees. And, on the other hand, the main legislator of the time, Ludovic George Mauder, was German. In 1834, Mauder drew up four basic laws, one of which, the Code of Political Economy, applied for 150 years until 1968. Among the most important laws that were passed and which still apply in the Greek state today were the Civil Code and the Penal Code.
Στην συντακτική επιτροπή του οποίου ήσαν οι τότε καθηγητές σχολής Μπαλής, Τριανταφυλόπουλος, Μαριδάκης, Πολυγέννης, Δεμερτζής. Στη συντακτική επιτροπή του κώδικα της πολιτικής οικονομίας, μέλη αυτής ήσαν ο Ράμος, ο Μιχελάκης και ο Μητσόπουλος. Στο ποινικό κώδικα έδωσε την πνοή του ο Νικόλαος Κοραφάς. Αυτή είναι και η σημαντικότερη γενική νόμη οι οποίοι ισχύουν στο ελληνικό κράτος.
The 19th century was a golden age for the study of law. At the direction of successive governments and of elected representatives of the people, Greek academics gradually developed a legal system that answered the needs of the country. Within this chamber of the old parliament, the legislative activity of the modern Greek state was developed, frequently reinforced by academics from the law school. The law school, through its graduates and its teachers, dominated the political life of Greece. Prime ministers and presidents of the Republic, such as Eleftherios Venizelos, Alexandros Papanastasiou, George Papandreou, and Konstantin Karamanlis, were graduates of the law school, while Konstantin Tsatsos and Panagiotis Kanellopoulos served as professors of the law school. The majority of both MPs and ministers in the Greek parliament are graduates of the law school.
At the time of the drive for further liberation of Greek lands in 1912 to 1913, the university was passing through a period of reorganization. The university union was dissolved and its place was taken by the student association, in which the progressive youth of the university was active. Its influence, however, on the university scene was somewhat checked by the military events that then took place, in which the student population and the university as a whole made a significant contribution. As the Greek armies liberated one more area after another, the university and its professors supported the cause, while students abandoned the lecture theatres for the battlefield. By the end of the Balkan Wars, Greece had won back lands that had until then been under the yoke of the Ottoman Empire. Thessalonica, Ioannina, and the islands of Chios, Samos, and Lesvos were liberated. The Greek border had suddenly moved from Thessaly to Evros, and Crete was once again reunited with Greece.
The University of Athens could not remain unmoved by events in the Greek world throughout this painful decade, the decade in which Greek ambitions in Asia Minor were brought to a catastrophic end by their defeat near Smyrna in 1922. The university was a nucleus of political and ideological activity and conflict, and its students, whose numbers had increased significantly, were in the vanguard of the struggle for political freedom. In 1922, two major developments took place. Firstly, the dramatic increase in the number of students meant that necessary materials and equipment in the university were inadequate. From 1,500 students in 1921, we reached 5,000 students in 1925. And secondly, the adoption of a new university organization in 1922 constituted an attempt to undermine the institutional framework that had been introduced by the previous organization back in 1911. 1922 not only marked the end of a line in Greek foreign policy as regards Hellenism in Asia Minor, but it also marked the beginning of the spread of revolutionary ideas. Thus, problems in the educational system were now confronted using not only academic but also social and political criteria. From November 1924, a part of the student body pressed more urgently for a response to student demands and requirements. The state responded to this student activity by arresting and expelling from the university the more militant elements. At the first student congress in 1924, a petition demanding the reinstatement of those who had been expelled was read out.
Since the beginning of the 18th century, the creation of experimental schools had been felt necessary in many European countries. In this way only, new scientific methods would be able to move from the experimental stage to more general use. In 1929, the experimental school was set up. It aimed to provide and develop both practical and theoretical training for school teachers. The experimental school has a single class and a six-class junior school and a six-class intermediate school, annexed to the workshop of Experimental Teacher Training School of the Arts Faculty, otherwise known as the School of Philosophy. The Foundation Act stipulates clearly the role of the experimental school within the education program. The school should function as a platform for the experimental application of new teacher training methods concerning crucial aspects of pedagogy, the timetable and content of the teaching program, the arrangement of the teaching material, examination methods, and teaching and school supervising methods.
At the time of the foundation of Athens University in 1837, no provision was made for a department of dentistry in the School of Medicine because there were no qualified dentists to teach and neither were there candidates to study dental medicine. The Medical Congress, an institution corresponding to today's highest council for health, examined candidates who wished to practice as dentists and granted permits accordingly. In 1911, and after two private dental schools had been set up, the University Dental School was established as part of the medical school. The course lasted 3 years and was taught by members of the medical school. In 1921, an independent dental school was founded at which four professorial chairs, especially for dentistry, were set up. The course was now of 4 years duration. In 1953, the dental school was renamed the Department of Dentistry within the School of Medicine. The dental degree constitutes a 5-year course. The department acquired the right to award doctoral diplomas and to appoint lecturers. From 1966, the department was also given the right to elect a president from its own ranks and to be represented on the Senate. In 1970, it became a separate and independent dental school. In 1982, it was renamed the Dental Department as part of the School of Health Science. Today, it has more than 1,500 students.
The Gymnastics Academy was set up in 1932, while before that there had been a school of gymnastics in Nafplio that had been in existence since 1834. By the Foundation Act of 1982, the Department of Physical Education and Athletics was set up at the University of Athens. The purpose of the department is to promote the study of physical education and athletics, backed by academic teaching and research. The studies program of the department covers two main fields, general physical education and specialized training. Among the lessons which all students have to follow are anatomy, human physiology, pedagogy, psychology, and an introduction to philosophy and sociology. Specialized courses include PE, traditional athletics, gymnastics, and other individual athletic events.
In 1923, the university club opened for the first time. At the inauguration ceremony, Professor Zengelis described its aims. Intellectual nourishment is provided by the university. However, this should be followed by a good dessert, that is, relaxation and entertainment, which this club intends to provide. Besides providing the so-called dessert, however, the club, in the course of its long history, became a center for the exchange and class of ideologies and politics within the student movement. The club also includes a foreign language school and a health service. It also has a music club, a theater company, a student restaurant, and a reading room. The university club building was indeed a center for student life, while student members amounted to several thousand and the faculty buildings were in the center of Athens. Today the club has lost to a large extent its old importance since it's not big enough for today's student population when we see that today's student population is roughly 50,000.
In the turbulent decade of the 1930s, the aspirations of the student movement were not limited to only university issues. Publications of the time clearly show this. Demands of a social nature are put forward, while accusations are launched against the government, saying that it aims to make education a monopoly of the higher social classes. In 1932, a law was published by the Minister of Education, George Papandreou, in the Venizelos government, concerning the organization of the University of Athens, which was so successful that it was in force right up until 1982. In the same year, however, militant demands were made by students for the abolition of tuition fees and for grants to help those without financial means, and the re-enrollment of all those who had been rejected by special law due to their political views, and the free expression and exchange of ideas within university precincts. With the restoration of the monarchy in 1935, the police force undertook to admonish the students, while professors in favor of the Republic were dismissed from their posts. However, the students rallied against these actions by calling an all-student assembly in May 1936. The assembly didn't manage to complete its objectives. When the so-called nationalist students had left the assembly, those that remained were forcibly removed from the university premises.
Η
The dictatorship of Metaxas that began on the 4th of August 1936 tried from the very beginning to silence any opposition from among the university community. In his first message to the nation, Metaxas, brandishing the threat of communism, said, "Communism has infiltrated our education system, corrupting the greater part of that system, from the university right down to teachers of elementary schools, thus having a disastrous influence on the youth of our nation." By setting up the National Youth Organization and discontinuing all other youth organizations of both political and cultural kind, he attempted to enforce the will of the regime. With the appearance of the National Youth Organization, the government spokesman for the organization said, "From the moment that you take the oath of membership, you become soldiers and fighters for the ideals of Greece and for the ideals of the 4th August government. In reality, these are not different ideals, but are one and the same ideal, that is the eternal Greek ideal. The 4th August regime is one and the same with Greece herself." The dismissals, as well the exile of democratic professors and the creation of a student branch of the National Youth Organization, did not break the democratic aspirations of the greater part of the members of the university community. In the spring of 1937, the 100-year anniversary celebrations of the university gave it the opportunity to show the contribution it had made to the history of the country. In the next year, however, an already existing law was altered, thereby allowing the regime to exercise absolute control over the university. The minister determined who held professorial chairs, and by this strategy, the government completely undermined the autonomy of the university.
The demoralization of education during the German occupation in the Second World War was all too clear to be seen at the university, despite endeavors by university staff and students to keep the flame of learning alive. The government set up by the occupying forces discontinued entrance examinations and allowed the mass enrollment of students. This collapse of standards was to produce a whole class of graduates that were to have a drastically debilitating effect on the university for a further two full decades. In December 1941, the Germans requisitioned the university, and on New Year's Eve, at a drunken party held in the ceremonial hall, paintings and busts of Greek historical figures were destroyed. Most of the older students left for the provinces, and many became leading members of the various resistance organizations. Dozens of them were executed or killed in action, fighting against the occupying forces. The activity of students and the presence of university teachers in the leadership of the anti-fascist struggle in the mountains of Greece and in the Middle East meant that once again the university was playing a major role in the history of Greece.
October 1944, Athens celebrated its liberation. From early morning, the students gathered as always before the university, and then along with the people of Athens, they all poured into Syntagma Square. Throughout the occupation, the students' role in the resistance activity extended through the whole of Greece. The part that students and undergraduates played in the resistance in the towns and villages belongs to the heroic struggle put up by the entire Greek people during the war.
The forecourt of the University of Athens, is graced by many memorials to those who gave their lives for Greece and its liberty from the 18th century until today. From the days of Kapodistrias and Korais in the early 19th century until the liberation from the German occupation, the struggle of the Greek nation for independence, freedom and prosperity has been indissolubly linked to the struggle for education and social justice. And members of the university have always taken part in every crucial moment of this struggle. Here is the memorial to those who died in the Balkan Wars, the defense of Greece against the Italian invasion of 1940, and the resistance against the Germans. The list, however, is incomplete. Many of the names of those university members who died in the social and political struggles of the past 150 years of the university's existence have unfortunately been lost to us.
Professor Gazis.
The University of Athens, during its 150-year history, experienced in parallel the tumult of events that afflicted the country as a whole. Students took part in all the political struggles of the country, often taking a radical stance, along with lecturers and teachers. When I was a student, the student movement was almost exclusively concerned with its union politics, that is, with questions of student fees and student meal coupons. During the Metaxas dictatorship, there was an exception when the French Minister of Education, Jean Jay, and member of the government Front Populaire of Léon Blum, gave a speech. There, at the speech that he gave, there were demonstrations and some arrests. During the German occupation, students were always active, either as a group or as members of organizations to which teachers also belonged and which were important in the resistance. After liberation and for a long time following, one of the main issues was the Cyprus problem, about which there were often large demonstrations. Then, during the early 60s, the students took on a more directly political role. They demanded civil and political rights, especially for the banned communists, and they also demanded that 15% of the national budget go towards education.
The armed struggle for liberation of the people of Cyprus has stirred the hearts of all Greeks. Again, the University of Athens has taken part in supporting the Cypriots' cause. With petitions and well-documented texts, the University Senate briefs the governments of Europe and the USA, while it also seeks support for the Greek Cypriot cause from educational establishments throughout the world. There was a strong show of student force at a large demonstration in the summer of 1953. This sparked off the beginning of militant political activities and violent clashes with the police. In December of the same year, and on the occasion of the resolution voted by the United Nations on the Cyprus question, another demonstration took place. In Syndrome Square, clashes broke out between police and students in which over 60 people on both sides were injured. Demonstrations on the Cyprus question continued until 1956, when they reached the height when the English executed two Cypriot nationalists. In Athens, sympathy protests and demonstrations resulted in bloodshed. Three young protesters were shot dead by police, while dozens of people were injured after long clashes in the center of Athens.
On the 3rd of December 1962, the slogan 15% for education was first heard at a demonstration. This was a demand by students for an increase in the state budget for education, amounting, that is, to 15% of the total state budget. Student protests continued with intensity in the years that followed, and they brought to the surface one of the country's most acute problems. Education was in desperate need of increased state support in order that it might make good the gaps that had accumulated in the preceding decades. The managing committee of the university declared that education was in crisis. At the same time, the National Student Union of Greece was created. At the fourth All-Student Assembly in April 1963, the student proposals were set forth. The establishment officially of Demotic Greek, modernization, democratization of the educational system, increase in the education budget, free expression of ideas, and the linkage of education with society and its needs.
As we have seen, the student movement began almost simultaneously with the foundation of the university 150 years ago. However, if we exclude the years of intense student politics during the time of the First Republic and up to the dictatorship of Metaxa, we can see the qualitative break in the character of the student movement in the beginning of the 1960s and after. In the early 60s, the crisis in education was directly linked to the wider political and social crisis. Today, the student movement uses slogans from the 1960s, such as 15% for education, urging a solution to the problem in education. At the same time, it links educational issues to the more general political and social problems that Greek society faces. The upgrading of studies, postgraduate research, student accommodation, student grants, course books, and many other problems are all addressed and put forward by the student movement alongside other political and social issues. Other such issues are the relationship between higher education and productive forces, the value of university degrees in the various public services and in production, training and the use of new technology, and the relationship between Greece and the EC and EC education programs. Not just the student movement, but the whole university community is active in highlighting all these issues. All this shows the productive relationship between the student movement and the contemporary problems, giving relevant and mature answers to the questions that the future places before every young person.
Two years before the dictatorship of the colonels in 1967, student demands went beyond the purely educational and took on a clear political character. The old slogan 15% for education gave way to a new slogan, 114. This was a reference to the last article of the Constitution, which said that upholding the present Constitution is the duty of every patriotic Greek. This was the period when students, along with large sections of the Greek people, defended democracy against every internal and external conspiracy. From July 1965, with the intervention of the king, the elected prime minister was ousted from office, and there began a succession of puppet, palace-backed governments, the one following the other. Demonstrations and clashes with the police were a daily phenomenon, in which students, again, were in the vanguard. The violent clashes were not without their victims.
The military dictatorship of 21st April 1967 put an end to academic freedom and to the independence of higher education institutions. Dozens of lecturers and professors were dismissed from their posts. There were, however, some who supported the junta and who took up posts in the service of the dictatorship. Government committees were set up in the universities whose job it was to appoint lecturers on the basis of their political and social convictions. The dictator Papadopoulos, in his speeches at the university, outlined the aims of the coup and its methods.
The importance of this moment and the overwhelming emotions I feel do not need to be expressed in your presence here today. The sanctity of the university and the atmosphere within this auditorium, full of teachers of our nation and of our younger generation who are the hope for the future of our nation, make my task here before you today, and to which you have invited me, particularly daunting. If I do not succeed in living up to your expectations, please forgive me, as it is you who have created this most sacrosanct of environments.
It is unacceptable, he said, to ask 300 young people to stand here for 3 hours in order to listen to the teaching professor and then wonder why later, because there aren't enough seats for them, they come here armed with their chair legs to express their grievances. Despite this, the military junta increases the number of entrants to institutions of higher education in order to try and create a good impression. The problems of the university became more acute with the dismissal of many lecturers and the students, despite the police state and witch hunts, slowly found ways in which to react.
Among the thousands of those who were arrested during the dictatorship, there were numerous leading members of the student movement from before the junta. Many students and teachers were members of illegal resistance organizations. If a student was arrested, he or she was barred from all higher education institutions of the country. 1973 was the most important year for the student movement. On the 21st of February, a sit-in began at the law school. For 2 days, 4,000 students from all the faculties expressed their opposition to the regime. Earlier, in April and in November 1972, there had been the first large rallies of students, especially just after the farce of the official student elections. The slogans that were shouted from the roof and balconies of the law school were mostly political, but also some were trades union slogans. One student said, "We are seeking a response to a series of student demands, the which in turn requires the existence of trades union and political freedoms. Our problems must be discussed in freely held student meetings without the presence of government committees in the faculty schools, without government-appointed committees of the student unions, and without the threat of conscription. By necessity, our demands had a political character." The news that the sit-in was taking place quickly spread. People flocked to help the students in every way possible. Again, there were small clashes and arrests by the police in the streets round about. On the afternoon of the second day, and after police intervention, the students ended the sit-in. The new student rallies in November 1973, demanding the democratization of higher education institutions, were also linked generally to demands for the democratization of the country. These rallies culminated in the student uprising at the Polytechnic School, in which students from all branches of higher education took part. Security forces and the army intervened. There were dozens of arrests, and the blood of the students stained the streets of Athens. But now the days of the junta were numbered. After the Turkish invasion of Cyprus 7 months later in July 1974, the military dictatorship collapsed.
Professor Gazis.
The intervention of the state in the affairs of the teachers has occurred on quite a number of occasions. It was less often the enforced dismissal of those teachers who were unfriendly to the regime than the actual appointment of those who were friendly to the regime. This phenomenon appeared during the dictatorship. The teachers were certainly in a difficult position. Some went abroad in order to avoid state harassment. Some collaborated with the dictatorship. Very few actually collaborated with the dictatorship, but unfortunately those few were younger lecturers who were simply looking to secure their careers. The rest of the lecturers stayed in their posts and tried to preserve some dignity for the university and for themselves. Many were threatened with dismissal. The response of the illiterate officers of the army was, "We shall appoint corporals to teach in the university." Of course, they didn't appoint simple corporals to university posts, but there were many friends of similar ranking officers who gladly took up these posts. The common view tends to place teachers and lecturers in the role of intellectual leadership, and it asks of them, beyond their academic knowledge, to make available a more general education, to set a moral example, to show courage and other higher qualities. Unfortunately, reality is not like this, but this reality is the same throughout the world. If we see what happened in Hitler's Germany, in fascist Italy, and in occupied France, we see that such things have occurred outside Greece, and sometimes with greater intensity. Undoubtedly, though, there are and were shining exceptions which provide us with an altogether different example.
The governments following the restoration of democracy had to face the problems that had accumulated over the decades within the higher education. During these decades, both internal and international considerations and frequently stale political timidity had inhibited the role of the university in the scientific and cultural development of Greek society. Students, academic staff, and professors who had been against the military dictatorship pressed for the dismissal of those professors who had collaborated with the regime, and they pressed for a new law for institutions of higher education. The new bill put before Parliament fell far short of what was required and not only lacked political direction, but also its provisions did not propose any basic changes to the university system. Student and teaching staff participation in the university's various unions was introduced. Legal status was given to the principle of asylum on university premises. But questions of coordination within the whole higher education program, its connection with industry and reorganization of teaching staff and methods are hardly addressed at all.
Για την αναδιοργάνωση του διδακτικού φορέα.
The biology department of the science faculty was set up in 1970 when the natural history department was closed down. Within the biology department, continual attempts are made to adapt the courses to update educational and scientific requirements. Every year, both team and individual research projects are published in both Greek and international journals in theoretical and applied branches of the science. The biology department has many branches. Many scientists have contributed to the development of one of its most recent branches, biotechnology. This is a stereochemical model of a famous DNA, in other words, the chemical union which contains the genetic information that is passed on through the reproductive process from one individual to another and in which is contained the key to life. Its discovery in the early 1950s brought about a revolution in contemporary biology. Through an electronic microscope, an instrument capable of achieving very high magnification, the students can observe structures and particles of cells and even viruses, which is not possible to see with other instruments.
Που δεν είναι ορατές με κανένα άλλο όργανο, όπως για παράδειγμα κάποιες δομές του κιτάρου, αλλά και ιούς.
In the display cases of the Paleontology Museum of the University of Athens, there are fossilized animals and plants millions of years old that have been discovered in Greece. Students of the geological department are taught in the museum, and schools and various cultural organizations visit it regularly. The fossilized animals that have been discovered in the region of Attica are 5.5 to 6 million years old. Fossils include hyenas, dinosaurs, prehistoric apes, and giant turtles reaching a length of 3 meters. Elephant fossils have also been found in Crete and in the islands of Delos and Chios. Finally, we can also see here the largest egg in the world from the extinct bird genus Epiornis maximus. This was a bird that reached a height of 4 meters and seems to have become extinct in historical times. Two such eggs exist in the world, and one of them is in the possession of the Paleontology Museum of the University of Athens. In the island of Tilos in the Dodecanese, paleontological excavations are being carried out at the cave of Halkadion. In 1971, Professor Simeonidis discovered here dwarf elephant fossils from 7,000 to 45,000 years old. Since then, about 15,000 groups of fossilized elephant bones and teeth have been brought to light. The Zoology Museum was set up 125 years ago. At a time when there was no television or radio, the museum used to have thousands of visitors.
Student representative.
Without doubt, throughout the course of its 150-year history, the University of Athens has made an important contribution to the cultivation of the arts and sciences in Greece, and it has contributed more generally to the intellectual life of our country. It now has a depth and length of experience from which the academic community can draw support, as well as benefiting other sections of society. This long existence certainly provides us with the experience and knowledge and means to formulate a perspective for the future of the university and its role in our society. For it is true that the university and its functioning do not constitute simply an internal matter for the institution, but it also plays a role in the multifaceted development of society as a whole. The university also needs to reiterate continually democratic principles to support free and pluralist communication and to show that dialogue is a permanent feature of all its workings. It needs to value the global nature of science and knowledge in the continuing endeavor for its development, while at the same time it should preserve its Greek character and should look to cultivate humanist ideals. For in the end, we should remember that the pursuit of knowledge needs to be accompanied by an adherence to human values.
The Chancellor.
Exactly 150 years ago, Athens celebrated the opening of its university. On that day, from the early hours of the morning, as newspaper reports of the time tell us, crowds of people descended into the place where the ceremony was to take place. At 11 o'clock, cannon fire announced that King Otto had arrived, mounted on his horse. Members of the government were present as well as diplomats, though two ambassadors were absent for political reasons, the church synod, local councillors, lawyers, judges and others, along with a crowd of public employees and politicians of varying rank. People who had fought in the Greek War of Independence were also present, including, notably, Theodore Kolokotronis. School children had lined the road leading up to the university building, and they all held olive branches. The first lecturers and professors were sworn in, and the chancellor and the deans of the four faculties or schools, that is the schools of law, medicine, theology and philosophy, all gave speeches. Ladies and gentlemen, I have so far spoken about the beginnings of our university, of the day it was founded, of the years that led up to this and of the years that followed. I have tried to show how the university from its beginning eagerly sought to play the role and accomplish the mission for which it had been set up. It was an arena for education and knowledge, a source of intellectual activity and a center for Hellenism. High aims indeed for the spiritual rebirth and development of our country. Knowledge is strength. But let us not forget that there have been great moments of progress in the history of mankind when universities remained on the sidelines. There have been other moments, however, when human values themselves have been left on the sidelines. I think this observation may well apply today. It would be worthwhile reminding ourselves what Plato, the great philosopher, said in this very same city nearly 2,500 years ago. Every art or science, when separated from justice and other virtues, is not wisdom, but mere trickery.
If, as we can reasonably assume, the 21st century will be a century of technology, then universities everywhere, and not only that of Athens, will have to undertake new grave obligations. But today, before the 21st century has even begun, conditions are far from ideal, and these difficulties are aggravated by what are frequently radical disagreements. Disagreement is a stimulus for dialogue, but reasoned dialogue. The university is above all a forum for dialogue. On this, the idea of the university is based. The word university is an indication of this. It is universal. It is a meeting place for all teachers and students who discuss and debate their subjects. It's a place where there is a continually movement and intellectual activity and debate, and where the tendency is for initial roles and viewpoints to develop into new ones and for disagreements to be resolved. Universities should educate academics to a high level, to create specialists who can contribute to tomorrow's society. We should not forget, however, that when European universities were first established, the feature which distinguished them from other specialist schools was that they would provide a general higher education. Today, with increasing specialization, knowledge has become compartmentalized, and there is even a certain amount of opposition between academics of different sciences. Nevertheless, we need both the technical, specialized knowledge and the general, broader intellectual approach. The former, that is, specialization, gives us the possibility to do something. The latter, the generalization, allows us to understand the reasons and the purpose behind what we are doing. The fundamental mission of the academic, though, will always be the search for knowledge, for objective truth, which has an incalculable moral value. This is not, however, the only value. Mankind has lived through tragic experiences by putting aside other values, and progress in technology has often given us a cause for despair. The attainment of knowledge is above all a step forward. The accumulation of more and more knowledge, as Brecht warned us, can, however, lead us further and further away from humanity, humanity in all its wider meaning. The humanistic values must always remain paramount in any age, whether industrial or technocratic, and should always be the guiding light for the university in the formation of its moral outlook. Το ήθος που προάγει ένα πανεπιστήμιο.